So good morning and welcome to this opening panel of Rethinking the Human Sciences. I'm Aunpama Rao from History and ICLS, and my brief is to introduce our speakers who, although they require no introduction here, it seems to me. I will begin with Srinivas, who will be our first speaker. Srinivas Aravamudan is Professor of English and Dean of Humanities at Duke University. In addition to a number of pathbreaking essays on colonial genealogies of English and French Enlightenment, Srinivas is also the author of Guru English, South Asian Religion in a Cosmopolitan Language, which came out with Princeton in 2007, Tropicopolitans, which won the Outstanding First Book Prize of the Modern Language Association in 2000, and most recently, the book Enlightenment Orientalism, Resisting the Rise of the Novel, which came out in 2012, just about 3 months ago, Srinivas tells me, with the University of Chicago Press. The title of Srinivas's talk today is The Problem of Scale, Narrative Universals in the Human Sciences. And as Tata said, each of our speakers will speak for about half an hour, and then Lydia Liu, who I'll introduce thereafter, will give a short comment of about 10 minutes. Srinivas.
Thanks very much, Aunpama, and I want to thank Stathis for the very kind invitation, and I'm really looking forward to the day, and Nick Dirks for making some very useful preliminary remarks that help also contextualize the whole conference and my paper. So I'm going to try and keep within half an hour, and I'm going to be somewhat formal. I'm actually going to read a paper, so I hope that's all right. The humanistic disciplines are confronted today with problems of scale, scope, method, funding, and situation, whether these variables are inflected in sociopolitical or institutional terms. Sustained public criticism of the humanities comes in many forms. I think it behooves us not to dismiss these as bad faith attacks, but to engage the kernel of the objections posed. For the sake of economy, I will summarize six types of criticism leveled at the humanities recently, before we go on to the human sciences, which I will. The first type is a criticism of critique itself, the paradigm of Western philosophy for the last 2.5 centuries. Mounted by none other than Bruno Latour in the pages of Critical Inquiry, critique is said to have run out of steam. Critique is accused of being incapable of transforming its object through the classic Enlightenment strategies of denunciation and exposé. The second type of criticism of the humanities bemoans over-specialization. Again, this type of criticism might come from the liberal arts community just as much as from the general public, expressing a concern that idiosyncratic pursuits and antiquarian tendencies have undermined broader priorities. Here, the lower humanities of high school and community college teachers pull in a different direction from advanced humanities research at top-level universities, such as this one. The second criticism is also linked to a third, that the humanities have turned their backs on the public sphere, barring a few public intellectuals who can surf the media wave. Predictably, even these public intellectuals are criticized for furthering their own careers and seen as out of touch with their own less well-compensated and less mediatically exposed colleagues. A fourth criticism, somewhat linked to the third, is that the humanities have abandoned the canon, and indeed the cultural gatekeeping function that went with maintaining the canon at previous points in time. Of course, it is not clear that humanists could resume this function of an intellectual clerisy, even if some of us wanted to, given the vast structural changes in society, increasingly drowned by tsunamis of popular commodity culture, from pornography to Pokemon, the old audiences are now lusting after the all too familiar flesh, with high culture rendered as increasingly strange. A fifth criticism concerns the diminished vocational prospects for humanities majors, but this is also yet another indication that society has moved on and has less use for our kind of education, even as increasing enrollments in economics, business, engineering, computer science, and the health sciences indicate where the jobs truly are. And a sixth and final criticism, that perhaps adds insult to injury, alleges that the humanities are elitist and oriented towards the wealthy. This just harks back to the second point, that we need to be catering to the declining humanistic skill sets of the general population. Could there be a social consensus around redressing the massive decline of reading, writing, and critical skills, just as there was for STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics in the United States? I should say the president of my university, Dick Broadhead, is part of a big task force. He's the chair of this task force organized by the American Academy of Arts and Sciences to come up with some recommendation similar to that of STEM in the next year or so on humanities and social science skills. Let's see what they actually say. There have been attempts to counter these types of criticism through public humanities, as well as pointing to the interaction between the humanities and the so-called creative industries. In responding to this call for rethinking the human sciences, I want to chart the manner in which the current crisis has been brewing for much longer, where the definitions of both science and the human are deeply at stake in new disciplinary developments. To understand this problem, I want to begin by casting my net back 50 years and then work my way to the present. It is almost obligatory to begin with C.P. Snow's famous definition of the two cultures of the sciences and the humanities, where one side stood for empirical facts and the other side for interpretive values, and ask how any version of the human sciences aims to integrate these two dimensions. In his famous essay on La Longue Durée, published in 1958, Fernand Braudel also pointed to, and I quote, a general crisis in the human sciences, as they are all overwhelmed by the extent of the progress they have made, unquote. Braudel is concerned that the human sciences, and I quote again, still have to contend with an insidious and backward-looking humanism, which can no longer provide them with an adequate framework. Even as there is, and I quote, a monstrous body of research, old and new, unquote. As we know well, Braudel wished to turn history away from a history of events, l'histoire événementielle, to a consideration of structure, cycle, and the long term, where structure refers to, quote, a reality which survives through long periods of time and is only slowly eroded, unquote. Braudel was not just turning away from the ideographic toward the nomothetic, which he indeed was. At the same time, he was also suspicious of the nomothetic ideal of the social sciences. Through a long engagement with Claude Lévi-Strauss and the dream of structuralism, quaintly calling this a disciplinary focus on communication and social mathematics, Braudel insists that a history of the long term would not just have to be on guard against the event, but also cultivate an ascetic attitude of, quote, surprise, unfamiliarity, and distance, unquote, from what is otherwise the all-too-naturalized subject of history, even in the social sciences. Braudel rejects the dream of social mathematics as doomed because, quote, it is a combination of micromaterial and a concept of time which is almost timeless, unquote. The sociologist's notion of time cannot be the same as the historian's, and even sophisticated attempts to analyze multi-chronicities, such as that by George Gurvitch, are seen as lacking a full sense of historical time. A commitment to the longue durée for Braudel is not just the journey from the event to the structure, in order to return to the events, as conducted by engagé Marxists such as Jean-Paul Sartre, but that much more arduous journey that can speculate beyond structure to physical space itself. And Braudel says, we may call it geography or ecology. Here, he refers back to his intellectual hero and mentor, the French geographer Vidal de la Bache, asserting that, quote, the social sciences should make room for an increasingly geographical conception of humanity, unquote, whereby human history would be a function of the affordances of physical space, as is indeed laid out magisterially by Braudel's magnum opus, La Méditerranée, that proceeds in three massive volumes from the physical environment, to social and economic structures, and finally in the third volume to political events. The anti-humanism, if I know that's maybe slightly anachronistic as a term because that moniker came later, nonetheless, that's what I see it as. The anti-humanism of Braudel's approach is salutary in terms of how much it reverses an agent-centered notion of human history, making the human the effect of an effect, a possibilist function of planetary space. I would like to move from Braudel's eye-popping geographical anti-humanism as one earlier anchor of the future of the human sciences, where the nomothetic would itself be a middle ground, the ideographic, the surface events, and the environment, the absolute ground, as well as agent of the whole. The decentering of the epistemological subject by geopolitics was not geopolitics as it's used nowadays in political science, but a different valence of that term. The decentering of the epistemological subject by geopolitics was subject to debate even within the Annales school, where Braudel's deterministic possibilism was challenged by Lucien Febvre's greater predilection for voluntarism. However, if the issue of scale might suggest a static subject who needs the right vantage point to have a different perspective or even dissolve itself in the face of the epistemological discovery of vast stretches of time and space, there is a bigger challenge posed by the dynamic situation of science and technology altering the very ground of political legitimation and corporeal experience from under our feet. Over the last half century, the underpinning of the epistemological project of the human sciences has been dramatically transformed with the fait accompli of biopolitics and technopolitics. Here I turn to the early Jürgen Habermas's well-known intervention on the problem of technology and science itself as ideology. Habermas suggests that the confrontation between, quote, the social life world and, quote, the worldless universe of facts, terms that he takes actually from a reading of Aldous Huxley on science and literature, that these terms imply the need for a political and social regrounding of technological change. To quote Habermas, technical applications is how science enters the social life world, unquote, and therefore, quote, technical means employed in historical situations suggest that objective conditions, potentials, institutions, interests, have to be interpreted anew each time in the framework of a self-understanding determined by tradition, unquote. We can see an enlightened, if recuperative, Kantian humanism behind Habermas's confrontation with the extreme versions of instrumental rationality as unleashed by big science and its transformation of post-war society. Remember, this is written in 1967, almost a half century before the new scientific revolutions in genomics, nanotechnology, telecommunications, virtual reality, social networks, and so on. All the same, in 1967, Habermas already sees a major discrepancy emerge between technology and democracy, the kind of question that Braudel completely sidestepped. As Habermas suggests, the situation of modern society is such that, quote, in place of the political will of the people, objective exigency emerges, unquote. Habermas quotes Herbert Marcuse, who sees technology as, quote, the intensified subjection of individuals to the enormous apparatus of production and distribution, in the deprivatization of free time, in the almost indistinguishable fusion of constructive and destructive social labor, unquote. Marcuse is working from the insights of Husserlian phenomenology and the Heideggerian destruction of metaphysics that render technology as pure domination, whereby all the functions of the body, from the motor apparatuses to the sensory apparatuses, eyes, ears, and skin, would be replaced by a telematics, only leaving aside the function of the governing center or the brain. And nowadays, we might say that even the brain might be up for grabs. However, the point of this account is not just a pure Frankfurt School-laden dystopianism, but a perpetual hope that new science would mean a new technology, and that neither the model of original sin or pure innocence would suffice. As we know, the communicational interactivity of a new medium starts off being liberatory and then transitions from an interactive subculture to purposive rational action and commodified exploitation. Consider email that is both the glue and the bane of academic life. Habermas's goal is to place these reflections about technical outcomes within a broader political dynamic of classical capitalism turning into its late version. Politics is replaced by the post-political, where it is no longer, quote, the realization of practical goals, unquote, but the solution of technical problems, amidst the depoliticization of the masses, whereby humans are integrated into their own technical apparatuses, cyborgs with none of the residual romanticism of Donna Haraway's definition. The ongoing legitimation crisis of late capitalism is central to the program of Rethinking the Human Sciences, I believe, in that behavioral control through biotechnical intervention and vast entertainment machines ensures that the evacuation of politics takes place even as earlier statist projects of welfare, medicine, and education are gutted by neoliberal market logic and the exclusions performed by biopolitical governmentality, as well as through market-oriented technopolitics. Moving on. Jean-François Lyotard's famous 1979 riposte to Habermas with his manifesto La Condition Postmoderne advertises itself as a report on knowledge, commissioned as it was by the Conseil des Universités de Québec. Lyotard sees liberatory potential in postmodern dissensus, where Habermas was seeking a liberal consensus as an escape route from the iron cage of modernization hypotheses. Lyotard attacks metanarratives, whether that of the emancipation of the human, derived from the French Revolution and Marx's radical reading of that event, or that of the totality of knowledge, an aspiration dating back to German speculative idealism, metanarratives at the heart of the inception of the human sciences, in whose place Lyotard seeks to recognize the incommensurable language games of a university bereft of a common meta-language. Lyotard still favors the critical power of the humanities over the functional efficiency of science, even though the reduction of science to one language game amongst others, according to him, allows new performativities through the epistemological instabilities that are created. The crisis of the university as a failed legitimation project, according to Lyotard, is enabling rather than disabling. But the recipe for the situation is not to seek a new grounding of the university's meta-subject, as some of us might seek to do, and I'm not sure if that is the thrust of this conference or not, but we'll see. I mean, it's certainly a possibility, but anyway, Lyotard is against that possibility. But instead of trying to newly ground what you might call the meta-subject of the university, what Lyotard instead intends to do is to revel in the paralogisms and the paroxysms, you might say, of local discourses that interrupt the ruined surfaces of the earlier edifice. Lyotard's provocation is based on a structural parallelism between the postmodern glut of information and the pre-modern staple of narrative. If informatics and cybernetics are at bottom reliant on algebraic algorithms, these mechanisms put code and data in dynamic relationships that level the playing field with respect to socially discursive language games. If the university consists of language games, even as the distinction between the functional and the critical falls apart, local language games can rend the fabric of philosophical autonomy and political rationality claimed by the Enlightenment. In the delegitimation of scientific consensus lies the potential, according to Lyotard, for the re-legitimation of narrative. But Lyotard's project appears to be a subterranean one of marginal cunning rather than a direct assault on the new redoubts of power. If knowledge has increasingly taken the place of nature, the university can no longer be the sanctuary of ideals, having already become the workshop of skills. If the public can be given free access to the memory and the data banks, I'm paraphrasing Lyotard here, social collectivities could begin to question the decisions that are made in their names, and the local and the temporary might rise unexpectedly to making the meta-prescriptive utterance and state the desire for justice and the desire for the unknown. If the technological reformulation of structures was Habermas's gift of an additional driver within a Braudelian framework, Lyotard's undoing of Habermas also suggests a fragmentation of the longue durée into local spatializations of multiple performativities, from which something radically new might arise again, even if we cannot allow ourselves to predict its gestation. I think I'm on time, that's good, 10 more minutes. Would simultaneous language games ever amount to more than multiple flashes in the pan of history? Does the technological transformation of the human in Habermas, or the informatic nodalization of the human as a pass-through in Lyotard, unmoor the geographical and environmental determination of history as suggested by Braudel that I began with earlier, given that nature has been replaced by knowledge, or is it information? There have been more recent attempts, I think, to seek a radical literary universalism under the premises that a cognitive evolutionary paradigm, by taking into account the science of mental states and insights about brain function, is a license for more vigorous historicizing and integration, as opposed to the straw man of cultural relativism implicit in a Lyotardian perspective. Art, literature, music, and culture more broadly are social institutions performed with reality effects, as indeed are nations, borders, genders, sexualities, and ethnicities. As cognitive theorist Ellen Spolsky asserts, and I quote, particularly successful works of art, like other enabling innovations, are engines, not reflections of culture. The most successful of them have the potential to bring audiences to new understanding, unquote. But when Spolsky goes ahead to see, and I quote, stories and paintings as artifacts on a par with arrowheads and antibiotics, unquote, the plea for a persistently creative modular mind runs the danger of complete de-differentiation. I mean, I guess it's really a question, is Guernica like an antibiotic? I sort of wish it was, but I don't think it's worked, at least not when Colin Powell covered it over during the you know, plea for the Iraq war in the UN. Perhaps, as Liz Gross argues, culture proceeds by way of a subtractive method rather than the usual idea that it's a supplement, impoverishing rather than supplementing nature. But if that is so, the expansion to a wider field from culture to nature sometimes has us losing a sense of history through bewildering multiplicities of scale. We are back to asking whether the Braudelian challenge of the longue durée has ever been addressed. As Dipesh Chakrabarty's recent essay, The Climate of History, suggests, climate change challenges the very idea of history by undoing the age-old humanist distinction between natural and human history. Although the intellectual trajectory that Chakrabarty charts within the history of historiography does not fully acknowledge the extent to which both Braudel and Foucault, who I didn't discuss, had already preceded him on this anti-humanist approach, Chakrabarti recuperates his model from a direct engagement with Vico and Marx. The important point is that Chakrabarti gives the geological name of the Anthropocene to the longue durée. The move from geography to geology with the concept of the Anthropocene, geography in Braudel, geology here with Chakrabarti, the move from geography to geology is a significant one, as it is also a move from a human science of environmental life to a natural science of species death. Braudel's epistemological vantage point was Olympian, unrestricted by the trivialities of individual human lives, but steadily focused on replacing human being with a becoming that arose from geographical and structural possibilisms. However, the epistemology of the Anthropocene puts the history of capital in conversation with the history of the species under the sign of the impending catastrophe of climate change. Such a geological move forces an interaction of environmental cycles with economic ones, even as it suggests that the epistemology of history might be thoroughly compromised. If the longue durée rethinks history from the eternal vantage point of Mount Olympus, the Anthropocene does it from something like a thanatological vantage point of Hades. If we take the Anthropocene seriously, we actually do have an opening, though. Not an opening in terms of deep history, something that Braudel strained to reach but did not quite achieve. However, the implications are just as much in relation to the human past and not just in terms of our future. As Daniel Lord Smale suggests in his volume on deep history and the brain, and Nick very helpfully referred to the brain and to sociobiology, Smale suggests that prehistory as a category was always introduced by historians as a buffer zone, relied upon by them to separate the human from the animal. This is where the massive expansion of scale in the human sciences can be embraced as a real innovation, where animalities come in to replace the anthropocentric version of the humanities, even as the sciences are reconfigured in relation to technology, not just as instrumental rationality, which is science in action, but as environmental impact in terms of what we might call the planet as reception. The reception history of science is the planet as the Anthropocene and the, you know, biological world. A new focus on animalities allows us to occupy both positions, the ideographic and the nomothetic, in a reconfigured version of the human sciences. A new approach to the evolving brain within its environment undoes the sharp distinction between the human and the animal, as well as the dichotomy of the agent and the environment. Here, the turn to neurobiology is continuous with the nomothetic side of the humanities, even as the turn to affect studies is continuous with its ideographic side. And the putting together of both the nomothetic and the ideographic, is crucially important in a Darwinian account of the species, which, of course, if it is fully embraced, deconstructs some of the vestigial pathos and humanist essentialism contained, I think, even in Chakrabarti's narrative of the Anthropocene. It needs to be reiterated that there is no essentialist ontology of the species in Darwin. In fact, I would say he was the greatest anti-humanist if there ever was such a thing. Furthermore, catastrophist accounts of the post-human, including Chakrabarti's, rely on a vestigial humanism to stage a frisson concerning their sense of an ending, in this case an imminent species ending configured as a mass suicide. While certain species have profound effects on their environment, as ours certainly has, they could also go extinct as the dinosaurs did. A rethinking of scale in the human sciences can recalibrate the age-old question of our place in the world as an expanded question about multiple versions of non-anthropocentric life worlds and worldings. Perhaps on the other side of the more productive post-humanist history of the human sciences, we have histories and practices of animalities, even as we have also have a history of what Smale calls the interaction between autotropisms and teletropisms within multiple species, including the human. Technology is, from the very long view, an interaction of species with environment in a manner to yield predictable and interactive outcomes that affect other individuals and species, both short and long term. The history of cybernetics, obligatory for a rethinking of the human sciences, could take place alongside a history of autotropics, whether this of, you know, things like commodity histories of alcohol, tobacco, sugar, and chocolate, also those of antibiotics and pesticides, but also those of virtual and sensory autotropics, starting with reading, going on to mass media such as film, radio, and television, and still on to the ongoing addictions of the new media and virtual reality that are transforming the species through a mechanism of coevolution. To the degree that such a transformation is incremental, it takes the culturalist interpretation of the Lamarckianism of short-term history as suggested by Clifford Geertz. However, if we have to encounter the implicit catastrophism of rubrics such as the age of the Anthropocene, we find that Darwinism again rears its head in terms of unmotivated species change. If we feel bad about human-induced climate change and the potential for a nuclear winter, we always have the killer asteroid to look forward to as a purely unmotivated event. If our species can and indeed ought to be held responsible for creating the conditions of our imminent catastrophe that it and other species have to experience, we have to acknowledge that despite our newfound powers and our very deplorable despoliation of the planet, we can always ready ourselves to re-enter the food chain for another species that will succeed us. Or we can always become a geological stratum if we are unfit to be eaten. The closing point of my paper is that we are neither immortal nor divine.
Our next and final speaker is Rosi Braidotti, who's distinguished professor in the humanities at Utrecht University and a founding director of the Center for the Humanities. Braidotti is the author of a number of groundbreaking essays in feminist philosophy, and she's perhaps best known to us all as the author of Patterns of Dissonance, an essay on women in contemporary French philosophy, which was followed by the trilogy Nomadic Subjects, Embodiment and Difference in Contemporary Feminist Theory, Metamorphosis Towards a Materialist Theory of Becoming, and most recently, Transpositions on Nomadic Ethics, which came out in 2006. Rosi's also recently published the portable Rosi Braidotti, it's called Nomadic Theory, which came out with Columbia in 2012. The title of her talk today is What is the Human in the Humanities?
Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here and a great pleasure. It's been really too long. I was just counting. It's been 15 years since I have set foot again in this wonderful, distinguished university. It's a great pleasure to be here. I hope it won't be 15 more years until we meet again. I want to try to make a case for the post-humanities, and it's not to bore you with another post. We've had them all. They're coming out our nose. It would have been the worst taste to do that before the first gin and tonic of the day. But I do think that the posthuman condition and all of you sitting in the audience have contributed to different understandings of the predicament is really a factor of our historicity. It's something that we may feel indifferent to, excited about, depressed about, but it's not exactly something that we can choose. I would be extremely historicist about this. It is the condition of the Anthropocene, as my previous speaker, Srinivas, pointed out, is the condition of two displacements that structure, really, the way we think and the way we position ourselves in reality. And it's a double displacement of humanism on the one hand and anthropocentrism on the other. And how you feel about this, however indifferent you may be to the end of the actual scientific discussion, depends to a large extent on what your investment is in these two terms, in humanism as a large part of the legacy of a sort of European worldview that, for better and for worse, through colonization and other horrors, has pretty much imprinted a long-lasting legacy on our way of thinking. That humanism and your investment in that is so completely crucial, and it is determined by what we call in feminist theory the politics of location, where you are positioning yourself from. And the politics of location is a situated epistemology. It's one of the great methodological tools that feminism has given to the world, and is too often forgotten in the discussions about the contents and the themes of feminism. But feminism is a profoundly epistemological movement. We've had very important things to say about the structures of knowledge. And our critique of universalism has replaced it with the politics of location. Think global, act local. Think from where you are. What are the conditions, the structure, your utterances? So the rejection of universalism, politics of location, which then became, in all the discussions through the 80s, situated knowledges, deeply influenced by postcolonial and race theory, has brought down a certain vision of humanism as the structuring principle of our systems of knowledge. I'm cutting a terribly long story short, but this is to be a crucial element of our discussion. How we invest that humanist legacy is really the starting point. If I read some of the scholarship coming out of North America, I'm thinking of the very influential work of Martha Nussbaum, I would almost believe that humanism is still to come. But my profoundly materialist Deleuzian feminist roots make me suspicious of messianic thinking. Whether it is communism to come, democracy to come, humanism to come, I've had it. There is no time for anything to come in the age of Anthropocene. We have to draw the historical balance, and being a dutiful student of Foucault, I think humanism is well headed. It's something that we have left behind. It's limited, it's Eurocentric, it's androcentric, it's universal. Is completely out of date. Thank God, it's over. Now, having said that and profoundly simply located myself with all the limitations of this location as a student of Foucault, as a Deleuzian, as a feminist, as an anti-racist, as a critique of Eurocentrism, of course, I've opened 1,000, I hope, possible discursive relations with you. And this politics of relationality is the other methodological tool that feminism and critical theory in the Deleuzian materialist mode has inaugurated. Multiple relational tools, multiple relational discourses, and multiple potential disagreements about this, but never mind. Critical theory is made of such relational moves, agreements, and disagreements. So I do not expect that we would agree on humanism as such, and it doesn't really matter. What matters is that we recognize that our investment in that concept is profoundly determined by our locations, and is profoundly determined by how we assess the anti-humanism, which has been a feature of critical theory in Europe, at least since the 1960s. And now, of course, we've all lived through, more or less covered with wounds, the theory wars and the critique wars of the 80s, those who were alive and vaccinated and well then. We all know all this brick and all of that stuff on French theory and its enormous limitations. And the crisis of the humanities is so linked with this debate about the status of humanism, which takes such different forms in Europe, where anti-humanism is pretty much part of the furniture, so to speak, as compared to North America, where humanism is absolutely, seems to me, alive and well and somewhat untouchable. And I would say that a great deal of the American deconstructivists are crypto-humanists. They always pull out the humanist trick at the end, one way or the other, even if it is just to celebrate some sort of discursive ethic. politics and some sort of Habermasian dream that we can talk ourselves into democracy. Not so in the deep anti-humanism that I come from. So that's the first big chunk, how we assess the posthuman of that. And it will take 6 weeks, at least, the studies of seminar to even begin to sketch the multiple epistemological political fronts of this. Let's then open the second front, anthropocentrism. Well, you may think that, or you may think of yourself that you had done your bit for critical theory, having pulled down the image of man as the measure of all things that was intrinsic, implicit in humanism. You know, the Vitruvian man of Da Vinci with the arms stretched out, that man, beautiful, drop-dead gorgeous, male, able body, blonde and blue eye, that one, him. You thought, well, critiquing him, you were already out of some sort of mental cage. In walks Anthropos. However deconstructive as you may be about all sorts of allegiances, when it comes to species allegiance, oops, Anthropos and his female counterpart, what is the female counterpart of Anthropos? The woman of the species is something that we are so profoundly attached to that the displacement of that, the critique of that, is all the more difficult, all the more painful, even and especially in the deconstructivist postmodernist front. So I think we need in our discussion to look at the two different posthuman predicaments. In a sense, it's easy enough to be a posthumanist, and we can imagine posthumanist humanities. Feminism would be certainly a postcolonial theory. There would be prototypes. Post-anthropocentric humanities, something that would be a species equality at the heart of our thinking. How would we go about that? So I'll spend a little bit of time on that post-anthropocentric shift, which in my work I've also called a zoocentric, a zoe-centric switch to something of a sort of post-human and post-species allegiance, profoundly egalitarian flat ontology. In my work, I do this with Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari, and Guattari's Three Ecologies is a fundamental text to try to comprehend this particular switch, as I will say later on. One annotation on the institutional politics of this. I think the instruments, the tools to enter this discussion, of course, owe a great deal to the critical tradition of the disciplines. And we've heard in the previous speeches and the opening remarks deep insights about the wealth and the repertoires and the profound vitality of the disciplines. It is also a case, however, that alongside the critique of humanism, we have had over the last 40 years, a proliferation of discourses, of paradisciplines, or parallel disciplines in areas which called themselves studies. And James Chandler, in the same journal article, the Latour, writes his breast-beating, maybe I was wrong, sort of male middle crisis, midlife crisis piece. James Chandler has this wonderful article on the proliferation of disciplines that call themselves studies, women's studies, postcolonial studies. There's so many of them, but I think it would be very healthy for you all to make your own cartography, your own list of disciplines that actually are studies, media studies, of course, performance studies, and after the end of the Cold War, peace and conflict studies. That's one of my, and recently, I have discovered at the University of Bath, how ignorant of me, death studies with a death study journals. That I'm avidly reading because they have great insights into the posthuman predicament, of course. So this great vitality parallel to and alongside the disciplines. What do we do with that? What does it say about the institutional management of this crisis of humanism? Are they supplementary, sort of excretion that support the massive superego of the disciplines? In Europe, history would be the super-egotistical discipline par excellence, a bastion of methodological nationalism, and then alongside all the little studies, post-colonial studies, Eastern studies, post-Cold War studies. So what is the correlation between the two? We always think of North American universities as profoundly interdisciplinary. And how true is that? And is your interdisciplinarity thematic rather than methodological? How interdisciplinary are the methods by which you actually tackle the issues of the humanities? The fallout of post-anthropocentrism really sets an agenda about what are the hidden structures that sustain a certain practice of the humanities, a certain idea of what Deleuze calls the image of thought, of what counts as thought, and what do you exactly do when you think, and who is the you who does the thinking to begin with. And the profound Eurocentrism of this notion of what the act of thinking is and the limitation of that image of thought are, of course, indebted to the critique of posthumanism. So the critique of posthumanism helps you clarify these hidden or invisible epistemological structures. But there are, of course, other factors involved here. And I tremble almost to mention them in the presence of Catherine Hales, who's done absolutely pioneer work on posthuman conditions with all the complexities of that and the extent to which the old nature-culture divide, which for so many centuries in my discipline, philosophy, had conveniently sort of set a number of discursive boundaries. Philosophy is a fantastic discipline. It's a proper discipline, not just a university department. It's a discipline. It's been out there for over 2,000 years. Things are clear in philosophy. We know what the human is. We know what the other of the human are. They've always been the same, and they've been always woman, native, and others. Difference is about axes of sexualization, racialization, naturalization. It has always been so, it shall always be so, says philosophy. So it's a great discipline to study because things are very clear. So there's the human, and there are the axes of non-human, of difference, and they are sexualization, racialization, naturalization. The sexuality, ethnicity, race, and then the earth others, the animals. And those are the boundary keepers of some sort of human condition, of some sort of privilege of anthropos, whose life has a generative, discursive quality. It's bios is biological existence, is in fact a political, discursive existence, as opposed to the life of the others, zoe, that is of a non-human, of a non-discursive, of a much more disposable kind. And this split bios-zoe is in fact a hierarchy of species. It is an ontology of categories that has conveniently placed the human in a very hierarchical position. And this human, anthropos, whose others somewhat, racialized, sexualized, naturalized, fall out of the magical golden circle of discursive rationality. What a great deal that was. What a fabulous trick. Man, the rational animals, and from there on all the others fall out, or they are connected to both rationality and the politics of it through some sort of negotiation and mediation with that anthropos, who of course doubles up as men, as the measure of all things. Fabulous. What a great narrative. No wonder it is so very difficult to tackle. So why is the post-anthropocentric turn upon us? Because it is our own science and technology that has brought that sort of race and species hierarchy tumbling down. It is one of the most fabulous things about the current scientific revolution, and we're in the middle of a fabulous scientific revolution, that it is the conditions of our own scientific research that question that primacy of anthropos. It is our own neurosciences. It is our own biogenetics. It's our own understanding of the continuity between upper primates and lower primates and ourselves. It is our own ability to create new material, new matters through nanotechnologies, etc., that has displaced that millennium-old sort of position of a certain notion of the human and the species hierarchy that goes with it. The technological mediation that now intervenes between us and what we used to call life, the profoundly intimate connection between technology and what used to be life, makes Zoe, non-human life, again a very crucial element of our historicity. The difference being that this non-human life, this Zoe, is technologically mediated. If we read Hales, if we read Haraway, if we read Deval, if we read all Patricia Churchland, all the people are sort of coming at the post-anthropocentric through the angles of contemporary science. It is our own science that has brought about this phenomenal redefinition of what counts as the basic unit of reference for anthropos, for that human. Are we, the humanities, capable of living up to it? The answer is yes. I reassure you now so you can relax. But before I give you that, I want to insist for a moment, because it may seem a banality, but it is at the level of thinking very complicated, to insist on this, the factor of how human non-human relations now involve complex machinic interfaces and assemblages. I don't know how well read you are into all the environmental stuff and the Gaia hypothesis, eco-criticism. Anybody here from the start, from the big witchcraft movement and all of that? I don't know to what an extent Maturana and Varela concept of autopoiesis is part of your genetic code, of your reflexes, the self-organizing nature of matter. Well, that self-organizing, beautiful 70s concept, very lovely. But that self-organizing vision of matter now needs to be remixed with Guattari's three ecologies and be plunged directly into the technological machinic world that we're living in. The machines themselves are self-organized. They are alive in some fundamental sense of the term. Our own technology is life and living and self-organizing. So machinic autopoiesis is the feature of post-anthropocentric thinking. And if you have worked through this with the texts, which again are confined to an area, you're sitting down, that we call science studies, because we don't know what to do with them, but the science studies has actually been tracking very carefully and very rigorously this slippage, this decentering, this coming of machinic autopoiesis. And Bruno Latour, actor network system is a very simplistic, in my line early, but simplistic rendition of a far more complex system. What is missing from Latour is any understanding of the extent to which human subjectivity is both an integral factor of and an effect of this machinic autopoiesis. Latour's critique is in fact a critique of his lack of concern up until date for something that I would call epistemology and subjectivity. Welcome to the need for rethinking the subject in terms of machinic autopoiesis instead of dispensing with it altogether. Second consideration, quick, because it's more of a sociological element, but the post-anthropocentric switch, which is brought in by our science and technology, is picked up with a vengeance, with panache, with glamour and with brilliance by advanced capitalism. There is a perverse post-anthropocentric turn occurring under the aegis of globalization or the new advanced capitalism. And it takes the form of global trafficking of anything that moves, of anything that lives. Advanced capitalism, as Luciana Parisi has argued, following from Margulis and again Guattari, is biogenetic capitalism. It trades on the codes of life. It is the work that Nick Rose has been doing on the politics of life itself, the work of Sarah Franklin on Dolly textures and mixtures. And we are profoundly interested in controlling and duplicating the codes of all that lives. Human genome program, but of course, vegetables and fruits, and entire species. If you've been reading again, people like Vandana Shiva, her work on biopiracy, and a little bit more upbeat work on earth democracy, is about the necessity to join forces to stop this merchandising of seeds and cells and the minute sort of code, encryptions of codes of living matter. That is the capital that we quote in our own stock exchanges. That is what matters. And of course, all of our stem cell research and the nanotechnologies that go with that push along the same line. And again, it's our science and technology, it's our stock markets, it's our own brokering firms that are doing this. It's not little green men from Mars. It's our culture, it's our world, it is our own post-anthropocentric turn. But somewhat, we step back from it in horror, thinking, oh my God, and it's called very terribly posthuman. It's all terribly disturbing, as if somebody else was responsible for this, other than our university, our banks, at the end of the day, ourselves. I have many of my former students working in this system, and it's, as I said, it's a phenomenal moment in terms of a scientific revolution, but the perverse post-anthropocentrism that comes from is this trading in anything that lives, whether it is trading in animals or body parts, or quite simply the capital values of codes, genetic codes, living codes, is a feature of our reality. This is why I said at the beginning, it's not as if you sort of psychologically can choose to feel, I don't feel very posthuman today. Well, it's good for you, but it changes very little to the actually material condition of production, as my Marxist friends used to say, of knowledge and capital under advanced capitalism. This perverse post-anthropocentrism then generates in a little nostalgic sort of twist, which is typical of the spinning machine of advanced capitalism, new forms of neo-humanism. And my example for this would be animal rights. So after we have absorbed them, vaccinated, processed them, you know that a cow in the European Union gets something like 2,000 euros a year in subsidies. That's one cow. I think your cows get even more if you check the state subsidies for American cows. So after we've done all of that, after we have actually controlled in the genetic codes of all of these genetically modified species, with all big, of course, paranoid social debates about genetically modified food, then we realize that species, animal species, are in danger, and we read of Peter Singer, or for that matter, 2006, Martha Nussbaum on Frontiers and Justice, and then we run out and immediately give human rights to what's remaining of the animal species, trying to protect them from ourselves. And I think this kind of neo-humanism that comes under the cover of animal studies and other studies, and from animal studies to animal rights, is something that begs many questions, but has very great symptomatic value. Certainly in the work of Nussbaum, this comes with the need to reinsert humanistic principle in the perverse, inhumane, post-anthropocentric landscape designed by advanced capitalism. And this is why Nussbaum can say humanism is still to come. Never mind that we're in the middle of a big post-anthropocentric shopping spree on anything that lives, but okay, how we feel about this, I said in the beginning, depends completely on how you position yourself vis-a-vis that humanistic legacy. For me, both Singer and Nussbaum beg the question, really. Another form of neo-humanism that emerges is through giving moral intentionality to machinery. And the big guy for us in the Netherlands on this is Peter Paul Verbeek, also works very closely with Nussbaum, his new book with Chicago University Press on morality, machine morality, that our technologies actually are forms of mediation for our moral choices, and then we would do well to abide by humanistic principles in making the correct type of moral decisions through our technology. Martha Nussbaum comes regularly to Enschede to work with Peter Paul, and again, we have the same configuration here. I have enormous doubts about this. I said at the beginning, I come from anti-humanism, so I prefer to oppose to these, what should we call it, residual forms of moral universalism that are postulated at the back of this perverse post-anthropocentrism of our system. I prefer to oppose to them the more vernacular forms of neo-cosmopolitanism that emerges from post-colonial and race studies. Whether it is, again, Vandana Shiva from biopiracy, or whether it is the whole front of Paul Gilroy working with Glissant and the whole post-colonial front saying, you know, folks, there are many other forms of humanism than the Western one. There is humanism in, of course, every major culture and religion in the world, from the Hinduism tradition to, of course, Muslim, to from the African Ubuntu, from various either even New Agey form of humanism. We can reinvent humanism if we assume that we start from the decline of the West. Much more convincing to look at non-Western front and form of new humanism that assume that whatever it is, it cannot emerge from yet another revisitation of Kantian principles, but has to emerge from a more egalitarian planetary discussions about what will be the principles of a recomposition of our being in this together. Last 5 minutes and conclusion. Our being in this together. Who is we and what is this? We are in this together has the recomposition of some planetary sense of belonging, but has to start from critical analysis, who is we and what is this, i.e. detailed genealogical critical analysis of the starting positions, the politics of locations, and the organigrams of power, if you wish, that would allow us to recompose a sense of the human that may allow for multidisciplinary discussions on possible post-humanity. Post-humanity is both as post-humanistic and as post-anthropocentric. I think we should redesign humanities faculties as a series of post-humanity labs in which we would actually look by axes of research, look at the conditions that would allow us to recompose some negotiable, partial, but generic understanding of what counts as the human, what could be the humanist, what could be the new feminist renditions, what could be, coming in from my disciplines, what could be the locations of sexualization, racialization, naturalization in the world today, when capitalism is gobbling all of that up and issuing it as a stock exchange marketable type of commodities. How could we assess properly the enormous vitalities of those areas called studies that have really, since the 80s, produced prototype of new ways of redefining the relationship between the cultures, between the two cultures. Think of all the work, I was looking up my bibliography, Gillian Beer's work on Darwin dates back to 1983. On literary Darwinism. If you look at this work on the visualization of science, early Fox Scala, 85, Jordanova, 89, the early Barbara Stafford is also late 80s, 1990s. Think of what anthropology has done about exploding on the notion of life and making it possible, I'm quoting Marilyn Strathern from 1992, to think after nature. Think of the entire tradition of philosophical vitalist materialism, which goes from Canguilhem and Bachelard to their students, Foucault and Deleuze, and through them into the non-linguistic branch of post-structuralism, the materialist vitalism that makes thinkers like Jane Bennett and myself, Elizabeth Gross, and Masumi and Delanda, a great deal of the materialist, monist, vitalist of today, they don't have any difficulties thinking the nature-culture continuum. Reading Spinoza as a political thinker of monistic vitalism, of course there is species egalitarianism. Of course we are part of nature, given that nature is vital, self-organized, thinking matter that does not require the transcended consciousness in order to function. Are we going to get out of Hegel, or are we going to sort of die dialectics and forever? Can we move on to a monistic understanding of this continuum and with that build into that monism the technological apparatus, the technological mediation? Are we going to be worthy of this millennium, or are we forever going to be hooked on that man of reason, hooked on the species hierarchies of anthropos, and be completely not at home in the very culture that we've produced ourselves? Being a Deleuzian for me today means being worthy of what happens to us, being worthy of what we ourselves have brought about, not in any fatalistic sense, far from it, but with a very upbeat, affirmative conviction that we are in this together, this we being open, porous, transspecies, transversal, still capable of recomposing multiple allegiances, but really already having walked away without a grain of nostalgia from that hothouse of humanism, from the paranoia and narcissism, as Deleuze put it, of that ancient vision of the subject. We are in this together, that this is already a complex, singular context that we really need to be able to raise to. I think post-humanities have it all going. Everything is there. We just need a little bit of courage and a little bit of conviction. So my money is on it, and in that sense, I would summarize my learned lecture with a very simple statement: the posthuman condition rocks. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you both for two very provocative papers. We'll now have some comments that will also open up, I think, for questions from Lydia Liu, who is Wu Sun Tam, professor in the humanities and professor of Chinese and comparative literature in the Department of East Asian Languages and Culture. Lydia is also the director of graduate studies for ICLS, and she's the author most recently of Freudian Robot, Digital Media, and the Future of the Unconscious, which was published by the University of Chicago Press.
I wanted to thank our speakers for providing such provocative arguments. I don't think I have enough time to really do justice to their arguments, but I wanted to highlight a number of key points. Srinivas started out by giving us the six charges that are usually leveled at the humanities. I just wanted to refresh your memory about that. The first is critique now out of, are we running out of steam? I mean, in terms of our critique, humanistic critique of society. The second, we are too over-specialized in our own disciplines and our field of studies. And the third, many of us retreat in our own scholarly pursuits, which might be relevant or irrelevant to the larger issues of society, and only a few representative public intellectuals continue to speak to society. So, and then the fourth, the problem of the canon, is the canon, traditional canon, also becoming irrelevant to a changing society, especially the process of globalization. And then the next one is job prospects. And this is very real. We have heard lots of debates about that. Are we training students who are equipped to deal with a changing society, a changing world? And then finally, the final charge is that humanities are elitist. They cater to the wealthy. These are, I don't think we should be self-defensive about this. There are some very real problems in the humanities, so we really need to think about these issues. But now, how? I don't think I have the time to address all six of them, but I think there, for instance, the relevance of critique, in this context, would remind us of critical theory, and Rosi in her paper also refers to that, although she doesn't have the she didn't have the time to elaborate on this. Srinivas mentions Habermas and critical intellectual theorists who try to think about these issues. Now, Habermas wrote his critique, you mentioned it, in 1967. And I think the year before, a professor at MIT named Joseph Weizenbaum invented the ELISA machine. This was the machine computer program, which started this whole idea of natural language processing. And ELISA is a machine which is designed, which actually can do a, which is based on a script called Doctor, and essentially someone could type in a question and ask this psychoanalyst to answer some questions. I mention this is because Joseph Weizenbaum, a German Jewish exile who taught at MIT, was probably the only one at that time who read his Arendt and Hobbes and Horkheimer. It's very interesting that in his book on the computer science and computer power and human reason, he criticized instrumental rationality. I have not been able to find any other scientists benefiting from that kind of critique. So somehow there's a missed opportunity between the scientists and the critical theorists in the 60s when information theory and cybernetics were developing and shaping many fields and disciplines. And so the question is, what would be today's equivalent, this lack of interaction? And perhaps interdisciplinary studies would address some of it. But even interdisciplinarity itself came out of cybernetics. And World War II, and so how do we then think about our current situation and the crisis of the humanities? In fact, the crisis is not new. Every few years, we renew this problem, okay? It's not a new issue. But then what is new in our situation? For instance, compared with C.P. Snow's time, and C.P. Snow was writing, I believe, in the 50s, but he was responding to a development that started after World War I, that is British universities, especially Cambridge University, because C.P. Snow was not the only one at that time who was thinking about two cultures, but exactly what was going on. Actually, the scientists at that time were defensive, and they were thinking of the humanities discipline, especially English literature at Cambridge University, as being conservative. And of course, the debate was with Leavis. But who were the other scientists? There was Joseph Needham, a good number of biologists at that time, Conrad Weddington, who was attacked by Hayek for his left-wing views, right, in The Road to Serfdom. That's the book, right? And then there's also J.D. Bernal, the father of Martin Bernal, also a biologist. And these scientists were at that time trying to be intellectuals, public intellectuals, and some of them complained that they were not taken seriously. And I should also mention it was quite a struggle for the scientists to put themselves on the map in the public. When UNESCO was being formed, Joseph Needham was asked to attend some meetings, and he and some other intellectual scientists were the ones who insisted they should put the letter S, science, in the name of UNESCO. It wasn't originally there. Okay, so it was quite an uphill battle for the scientists to try to become intellectuals, because there was this conservative tendency in the structure of their disciplines at that time. Now, I don't think the issue has become one of a battle of two cultures. There are some larger transformations here. The scientists are not doing better at all. It's very much a new patronage system. And then when J.D. Bernal was writing for the public in the 40s, he was actually saying that the scientists should try to, you know, try not to enslave themselves to the state, to capitalism. And there were lots of criticisms of capitalism. So then I just wanted to recall this this background to help us think about where we are now. So I think there are some major social transformations in our time, which perhaps go beyond the consideration of the human. Now, Rose's paper. It's very interesting to hear views from Europe and see how they think of the differences between American university and the European universities. And then Rosi mentions a double displacement. One is the displacement of humanism, and the other is anthropocentrism. And she thinks of some of the forces that brought about the changes, the rejection of universalism, humanism, and she attributed it to the rise of postcolonial criticism, feminism, and other progressive ideas and theories. But she also mentions biogenetic capitalism. Now, this is related to the larger transformations that I have in mind. Of course, we all know that global capitalism is a major force in changing the function of the university. And the question is, would species equality be the answer, or a zoocentric approach be the answer to the problems that we encounter? Speaking of Eurocentrism, if we were to have this meeting in Asia, for example, would they ask the same sort of questions? Would they be concerned with Eurocentrism? Probably not. Then, so where exactly is the battlefront? If we were having this conversation, say, in Hong Kong, they would probably ask different sorts of questions. Now, but they're also faced with some of the same processes in globalization, and they will be talking about labor forces and how do you train skilled labor, right? University college students in China don't want to go into some of the manufacturing sectors which would demand skilled labor. And so the government in China is actually rethinking about their own educational policies, so then they would put more resources in the training of skilled labor rather than educating liberal arts university students. So now I wanted to put a neologism rather than post-human. I want to leave it to Kate Hales. Perhaps she will address that. I wanted to put another a neologism on the board, because on the map. Actually, it's a very important development in theory and in social change. I don't know if people have heard of this, this is a neologism that is made out of precariousness and the proletariat. This refers to those people who are in low income jobs, who work at low-income jobs, and who have insecurity in their career and future development, okay, the precariat. And there has been a lot of discussions of this. Now, why did I mention this? Because it's related to the function of a university, the proletariat. It's not exactly the proletariat, but these are information workers mostly, people who operate call centers. And then some of them are probably college graduates, but some of them are not. So how do we even think about this situation in terms of the what we can do as educators? And certainly governments are thinking about this problem, you know? So I think this is the problem of political economy that I wanted to bring up, and it's totally related to a lot of the developments that panelists this afternoon will probably address, information society and all of that. These are not new issues, but I just wanted to put it there on the map so we can think about, you know, what exactly is changing the world. So on the one hand, you have capital. On the other hand, capital is producing these kind of people, more and more of them. And you think about Foxconn, which is the sort of main supplier of Apple iPad, iPhones, okay, and the kind of people who work to produce these. And you hear about the news from time to time, but there are major transformations both here and there, and they are linked together by this process. Finally, I wanted to go back to a remark made by Marx in German Ideology in 1845. He says, the ideas of the ruling class in every epoch are the ruling ideas. I think this is still very provocative when we think about it. Okay, the ideas, the ruling ideas of every epoch are the ideas of the ruling class. I'm turning this around. And so then I think if we keep this in the back of our minds, maybe some of the issues relating to information society would become clearer. Thank you.
I have three questions to Professor Braidotti, if I may. The first is a distinction between zoi and bio, which you celebrate and break in it. But if we look into the history of zoi and bio, the account that we have on zoi and bio is false. If we go to antiquity and read Aristotle, whoever they read, we'll see that the distinction between zoi and bio doesn't really exist there. I mean, man is a zoon politikon, a zoon koinonikon. So the distinction that modernists trying to introduce into pre-modern history of the what is now the West is falseous. And if we go and say, well, we want to be Zoe, we don't want to be Bio, we're thinking in the horizon of the modernist, so we're not overcoming it. We can go back into the history, and of course, between Aristotle and Heidegger or Kant, whoever we wish to think, there were many people. There was Stoic thought and the culture of the self in the first centuries, with Christianity, East and West, with the medieval times of all the Abrahamic religion thinking about it. So we need to go back to the history that has its origin in the eastern shores of the Middle East and look for ways of thinking of bio and zoe that doesn't reduplicate the modernist distinction between the two. The second thing that has, I think, somehow continues the point is that as much as you're trying to be post-humanist, when you said it's not thinking about the, or talking about the perversion of capitalism, of post-humanism condition, you said, well, it's not green or blue people from Mars, it's us. And I think the us that you're referring to is us humans. And I think maybe one of the residues of post-humanist thought is that we as humans have responsibility for the world. And that's maybe a core of humanist that is left there. I'm not sure that we should throw it away, but there are residues of humanism in your speech. And the third thing is, how can we distinguish between your version of post-humanism and capitalists, let's say the bad side of post-humanism? I mean, one thing that strikes me about Deleuzean is to celebrate to the extreme of the schizoidic, whatever, of capitalism. What's the difference? I mean, we are ironic, but we celebrate it. I mean, how can we distinguish? I mean, both of you, both of the sides celebrate it. And if we look at actuality, we see that the post-human capitalism is thriving and it's everywhere. There are many potentialities maybe to think of otherwise, but it doesn't seem. And I mean, in the academia, we thrive and we live of the post-human capitalism, and especially in private universities such as this one. Thank you.
Yes, thank you for two very inspiring and provocative papers. I also have a question for Rosi Braidotti, following up on the previous question. And let me just begin by saying that I speak coming from Europe, but I happen to work on this side of the ocean. So now that I have located myself, I can utter my question. And the question is basically this. And it's probably the question of an unreconstructed deconstructionist, someone deeply steeped, or at least wish he would, in the questions of philosophy. And the question is this: I cannot see what empirical or conceptual grounds there could ever be for declaring the human, or the problem where that term, that philosophical term stood for declaring that problem of the human over and done with, or no longer still to come. And I don't think that in making that claim, one needs to be falling back into a position that one could call that of an idealist humanist, nor is one advocating a slightly suspicious form of humanism. And it seems to me that, reiterating some of the things that were just said, that there is no way around the question of the who, of the we. I think that some philosophers, with whom you would not cite, I suspect, brought it out, and I would say almost irrefutably so. And one can think of Heidegger, Sein und Zeit, thinking of the question of being, the being that we are, in anti-idealist, anti-humanist, anti-subjectivist, anti-narcissistic terms, by coining this neologism, well, not neologism, but this new use of this term Dasein, and at the same time admitting that the only way we find this new instance for philosophical reflection is through the question we, or another example, Derrida's paper, Le Fin de l'Homme, which ends precisely on this note of the qui nous, who is it that, that we are. And it seemed to me that indeed in your demarcation of the post-human from its capitalist perversion, that question of the we, or this question of the in light of what would one formulate an unease, or even speak of so much as perversion, comes up again. And that's the question one could say of the human, however much one wants to dispense with humanism. And finally, I think in your closing note, it struck to me that you appealed to something quasi-normative, and I think laudably so, when you appealed to the need to espouse courage. And my immediate suggestion was, or association was, that self-organizing systems or thinking matter neither have nor need courage, nor could one even say that they rock. So if that's the case, if one has to so resort to these moments, that of the we and that of the courage, that of the instance that differentiate between the post-human, properly speaking, and its perversion. Are we not, as it were, re-articulating, as we should, the problem that philosophically was named by that word of the human? So there is no such thing as the post-human.
Thank you both for fantastic papers and provocations. A question to Professor Srinivas and then a response to a point that Professor Lydia Liu made. You talked about the deep history of the brain, and the references were all debates within the academy. And I wondered if you would think about expanding to the conversations that are happening in what I would call popular airport literature on this very topic, the ways we think and what we are. And I'm thinking of two very popular best-selling books. One is Nicholas Carr's The Shallows, where he talks about neuroplasticity, and essentially it's an appeal for spending less time on the internet because it's destroying our ability to process deep information. And because he's that in-between generation where first 30 years of his life or 20 years of his life has been without the internet and the subsequent 25 maybe with the internet, he uses himself as a case study of the way that the way we think is changing. So that's the worried side, that's warning against the shifts in the ways we process knowledge and knowledge production, and directly linked to what you're talking about. And then the other side is Malcolm Gladwell, who in particularly Blink celebrates, he actually uses this thing, micro slices of information, and he calls it our 24/7 mental valet that helps us process information. But it's actually a celebration of fast thinking and actually not reading the whole sentence, reading the first word and the last word and making a conclusion, which I think is a very dangerous concept within this. So I'm just wondering if, what about the possibility of expanding to this growing body of literature that's also much more widely read, obviously, in this country, if you go by sales figures. And then just a response to Professor Liu about this idea of the precariat and you know, a concept that's been talked about a lot by Occupy Wall Street also, because of course that's another thing that allows so many people to join that movement is their precarious job situation. And Andrew Ross of at NYU has just written this thing where he calls it the spirited DIY layer of the precariat, pieced together lumps of income from motley sources at a far remove from the legal entitlements of the waged earner. And I think one thing we have to include in this concern about this precarious new forms of living is the role of the academy, not in producing people that can't find vocations, which seem to be one of the things that you're referring to, but also the way the academy is implicated in this, in particular the use of, this has been discussed, graduate students and that whole system of labor that is being debated about the academy's own central role in continuing this structure.
Gil has a question, and
we're not going
And maybe we need to stop.
No, let's take all the questions, but I will not
okay.
Answer.
Okay, so that one, and then there's a final one here, and then we'll give our speakers a chance to respond.
I suppose my question is somewhere between the dismissal of nostalgia and of melancholia. And I'm wondering whether might be related to the precariat as well. I'm wondering about the universalism, in fact, of science, I suppose, and of technology that seems to me to be at work in both papers, namely that it is we the species, who are doing to ourselves that which is now both inevitable or perhaps even better to be celebrated as the end of our humanism. The politics of location, if I may, seem to me to raise the question of whether the species is bringing about its own demise, even if we want to celebrate it, although it appears to be somehow catastrophic to some large segments of the world population, human or non-human, which seems to me to leave some space perhaps for some level of melancholia, mourning, and nostalgia. But even without going so far, isn't it strange that the science and the technology that we are living under would be claimed now for our species. Unless I'm mistaken, not all of humanities has actually managed to invent the atomic bomb. In other words, the technology to actually eradicate from the face of the earth a large number of individuals in an instant. Shouldn't credit be given to where credit is due and recognize that the level of devastation, if I may be so negative, the level of devastation that we are living with is not, in fact, something for which the entirety of humanity should take credit or even want to celebrate.
In your discussion, the precariat, I think it was characterized as low-income people. There are plenty of people, including myself, who, let's say, have are independent professionals, high-wage or high-rate jobs, but the conditions may change for a sustained period of time as they have the last 3-4 years, and also the structure changes, in my case, in the computer field, where certain values shift over to other tools than the ones that you may have, and you wind up very precarious. Because I was doing this for 30 years, and there'd be times, you know, things, there'd be downturns, and there'd be a chance to do other projects which took me into the humanities for a year, and then I'd go back and do my computer technical writing. So I would broaden the term. There are people who are precarious, but not necessarily started out as low-income people. Second thing is Joseph Weizenbaum. Okay, so 40 years ago, I was in a PhD program involving all of the technologists and the people from the learning point of view. How do you invent machines that can teach people? This was at CUNY. It was a new program in 1970. The person who made the most impression on me, who visited us, and they all did in turn, through the 2 or 3 years, was Herbert Simon, because he was another philosopher slash scientist, cognitive psychologist, who really, with one or two other people, started the movement. The information theory started in like 48 at Bell Labs in a very narrow technical sense. So by the mid 50s, you had people like Herbert Simon on the one side, and then George Miller on the other side, and maybe, you know, a few others who said, let's look inside the black box. That's of worth. Before then, you were a bad person if you did that. You weren't a scientist. Finally, I mean, the tools in the future, I mean, the personal computer is developing as a reflection, a mirror of the person himself and people like him. And that's where the humanities will come in. In other words, it's not against the tools, but the tools will begin reflecting the person. The person will have a deeper understanding, and that what the humanities and the neurosciences have to offer will will help not only the person get better, but the person who is dealing, responsible for other people like children, elderly, or people they teach will be more informed. I just wondered if there are any comments on anything I've said.
You want me to go first?
Yes, you have.
Okay, all right, I have to. Okay.
You're about the first speaker.
Yes. Okay, I'll try and be brief, but I will respond to all 5 questions because I just want to just, you know, at least keep the memory of the conversation, and then you can, you know, do the same or not, if you prefer. The first question on Zoe and Bios. I know it wasn't addressed to me, but I thought I would just make a comment on that, which I acknowledge the point of the comment, which is that to some degree this distinction is a modern distinction that tries to think of the way I would see it as a pre-cultural animality, which is called Zoe, and a post-cultural animality, which is called Bios, that recognizes that moment. However, I do think, from the perspective of a deep history, I don't know the extent to which that pre-modern-modern distinction is at least as sharp. Because the point about autotropisms and the kinds of things that we learn from a real understanding of biology, and I'm not a biologist, is that evolution could be described as constantly having that issue of transition of the residual animalities that then get reorganized in terms of something else that is more self-organized. And so while in the human historical context, one might say, yes, you know, this is the moment in which the social takes over from the natural, you have to kind of think of the coexistence of both organized and relatively less organized or random types of organizations. And so I would want to not sequentialize Zoe and Bios, but think of them perhaps side by side as possible ways of naming more and less organized forms of animality. So, I mean, that might be my response to that question. The question about who and we and deconstruction, my own sense is, you can call it what you want, and I do understand the question about how there's something about the human that always is left behind or is residual, and whether there's, if it's ever completely possible to be post-human. And I'm not as wedded to the vocabulary of the post-human myself, so this may be more of a question for Rosi anyway. However, I do recognize the point, and I'll come back to it maybe with respect to Gil's question that sort of connects to that in a different way. So I'll just come back to that point. I do want to say something about the neuroplasticity and the Malcolm Gladwell response. I haven't read the novels, by the way, but I think I understand the point. There's a colleague of mine, Kathy Davidson, who's written this book, Now You See It, which is all about the culture of distraction and how that's a good thing with respect to the way internet life and culture is rewiring the brain, I suppose would be the most summaristic description of what she's trying to talk about. I have to say, a little skeptical of the idea that all distraction is good. I think, from what I understand, there are some highly creative people who thrive on constant distraction and can recalibrate their thinking constantly and in a modular way and keep upsetting their modes of thought. But as we know, there's so many kinds of things that require attention that need to be learned with slow time. So this idea, and I reject the kind of evolutionary psychology stratum that sometimes is overstated with some of these ideas that, you know, in some Lamarckian way, the human brain is evolving so quickly that we can all become multitasking to the nth degree. I do think the quality of attention dissipates. I mean, I know this, maybe I'm stupid, which I'm perfectly willing to acknowledge, but I can't read a book on screen. I don't feel I have the quality of attention to give to it that I can with a physical form. Now, that's maybe a relatively trivial thing, but I think that's just a metaphor of, you know, certain things, I think certain kinds of things, interruptions and distractions, are good. I'm not necessarily advocating a monastic form of slow time, but I think some things do require slow time. I think art, certain forms of aesthetic production rely on deep attention that sometimes takes many years of thinking and rethinking and reconfiguring and maturing. This would be like saying, just take a very cheap analogy, but if you really believe that distraction and speed is perfectly acceptable and that it's surpassed slow time, then fast food should always be, you know, taste better than any kind of cooking that, you know, takes a lot of time and effort to produce. And, you know, and we know that that's not the case. So I think there are different modes of thought. There are certain things that distraction, a culture of distraction, might even need to be welcomed. But I'm not an advocate of the wholesale overthrow of different forms of time. And I think it's really a question of multi-chronicity. The problem with time is that it accumulates. It's not just something that ever supersedes. So what we live now is a world in which there's multiple forms of time, speed, attention, and we have to coexist even within ourselves in terms of how we manage all of these different forms. And I myself am less on the... I try and, you know, keep dividing my time in between these modes. So going back to Gil's question, that I'm very sympathetic to the question he posed, which is linked back to the question about the residual. I sort of feel that, for myself, I mean, Rosi obviously can speak for herself. I don't see myself feeling in any way celebratory about the post-human, and I'm not sure even if post-human is really completely post. And I do think there's something symptomatic about our current moment where to some degree it's easier to imagine, I mean, Frederick Jameson said this, it seems it's easier to imagine the end of the world than it is to imagine the end of capitalism. And I think that is a profound point. There's something about capitalism where either we've thrown in the towel or we just don't think that capitalism is stoppable. So we're perfectly willing to, and I'm including myself in this, we're perfectly willing to contemplate catastrophe, the end of the world, the Anthropocene, the asteroid, whatever you want to think about, and somehow take a kind of maybe over too quickly, and I accept your point, maybe too quickly a kind of collective responsibility for it on behalf of the species, when in fact, as we know, different elements of the human species are far more culpable and responsible for this engine of capitalism than the vast majority who are maybe cogs in the machine, but not pulling the levers. So there is this question of where either it's melancholia and those kinds of things that Gil referred to, or the residual question of the human with respect to this whole aspect. And this is where, in my talk, I tried to go to the question of animalities, and that's why I said we shouldn't only just rely on the nomothetic, which is the more science-oriented side of it. It's really the ideographic, which is to do with the particular and the specific, that has to go alongside that. So affect studies and all of these kinds of areas still rely on the individual or the individual member of the impact of all of these things and how they get registered in the body, in the psyche, and in very differential responses. So I think that might be the place. We can name it however we want, but that is the place of the residue of subjectivity, the human, if you like, the culmination of different aspects of the animal. So I think I tried my best to be fairly quick on, and thank you for your comment on the computer field, but I'm not sure I know enough to say anything other than and acknowledge it. Thank you.
3 minutes to do justice to this. Okay. Unreal. Thank you very much. I have 4 points, really, and that will intersect in all directions. But maybe just a caveat to begin with. The affirmative tone that is both temperamentally and theoretically my stand is not triumphalist, although it may appear so. It does take on, in a spirit of provocation, a sort of an intrinsic system of values that we seem to have in our critical theory community, whereby melancholia is intelligent and noble, and optimism is stupid and absolutely cheap. I have so had it with this that I now parade my Spinozist ethology of affirmative passion like a political statement. And I think that there is what is the difference between an upbeat experimental approach and a noble, melancholic, aporetic, and impotent one? Well, it's a qualitative leap. And in critical theory, ever since Nietzsche, we've been discussing this. And we have ample methodologies, including wonderful work on post-colonial melancholia that basically says to the whiteys, get on with it. And are you feeling bad? It's good for you. Now get on to the next phase. And it's called the methodology and the pedagogics of defamiliarization, of disidentification, nomadic thinking. Leave home, get a move on, and maybe around the corner, there's a whole new world waiting. But no, you can also sit down under the willow tree of melancholia and mourning and feel really, really noble about your deep intelligence and do absolutely nothing. So there is a huge discussion here. There's methodological, pedagogical, and it has to do with defamiliarization as a technique, as a practice, and I would say as an ethics as well. And in my new book, I have a whole chapter on this, so you can consume that. So it's not cheaply triumphalist, it is deliberately provocative, and we could discuss this. Very quickly, on the new recompositions of the relationship between the two cultures, I talked very briefly about the necessities of setting up humanities labs, and it's a praxis, it's a project to recompose the relationship between those two communities, but I was trying to indicate that there is a lot of work already done, and there is a plethora of possible new schemes that have already recomposed the relationship between the old humanities and the new world of science and technology and whatever we want to call it. There is an absolute urgent necessity to renew the vocabulary. I couldn't agree more. Bios and Zoe, it's all secondhand. We need fundamental humanities labs to talk about the question of terminology. And of course, I had teachers that I suppose you believe are very bad teachers. I studied with Deleuze, and Deleuze cracked every single word open, cracked the back of it, saying, like, get the humanism out of it, find other ways of saying, no, a new world requires new epistemological and lexical terminological thing. But this would be the humanities in the 21st century to really work on the language. And I will come back to the question of language in a minute. We are in this together. We are in this together is a non-human assemblage of complex singularity. It's not we human are in charge of the state of the world, let alone the course of history, let alone humanities faculties. The we in question in my scheme is a composite, transversal assemblage that includes racialized, sexualized, naturalized others, massive technological apparatus, and the social networks that go with it. And I don't mean social networks just in the media sense of the term. I am not responsible for bringing, I mean, I may be responsible for bringing the bad news, but I'm hardly personally responsible for the complex technologically mediated world that we're living in. And I'm very excited about living in this particular time. I think that the ongoing scientific discoveries are phenomenal. I mean, I get so excited to learn that I have 98% of my genes in common with the upper primate, and I just learned recently 76 with the cauliflower and 32 with the daffodils. I'm elated. Spinoza had it all right. He knew it already. What a fantastic sense of proximity to all these others. I find, again, if we had the vocabulary to explain this, what a phenomenal things this would be. But we are in this together. The we is absolutely not human. That this is a project to be defined. Again, we need a humanities lab on that one. The we of the science is absolutely not Western. Did I ever say at any point in my paper that the leading scientific cultures in the world are Western? They're certainly not. Stem cell research has China out there going like a house on fire. The Silicon Valley of India is producing 2/3 of the engineers of the world. Our meetings in Singapore, in Hong Kong, and we are going with a big Deleuze conference to China next month, prove the extent to which our colleagues in China are discussing precisely the same issues. They don't have Western humanism to worry about, but they're very concerned about the fate of the Confucian classics now in China, that the kids are no longer reading the classical text because of the technological revolution, because of the neurological revolution. So it's very analogous arguments, but they certainly don't assume that Europe is in charge of this boat, let alone the great declining empire of the United States of America. Obviously not. These are the emerging super economic powers of the world. And they don't give a toss, quite frankly, for the old empires. But their scientific cultures are gigantic. The government of China this year is investing 25% of the national gross product of China into science and research. The country I live in, the Netherlands, is investing 1.6 of its national product in science and research. Do we need to say anything more? I don't know how much you're investing, but probably don't even know, not having a centralized governing body anyway. Contemporary science is absolutely non-Western. It is truly global in some profound post-colonial sense. The question, how do we distinguish good from bad differences, it's a great good from bad examples of post-humanism, post-anthropocentrism. It's a great question. May I refer you to chapter 4 and 5 of Transpositions, and can I give you the short answer? And the short answer is we need Spinozist analysis of the ethical forces at work. We need ethology of forces to tell the difference between differences which are playful, I'm quoting Donna Haraway, and differences which are pillars of world historical systems of domination, between opportunistic forms and expression of post-anthropocentrism and actually affirmative, progressive, constructive one. The difference is an ethical one, and there are clear criteria that we can point out for this criteria that Deleuze and Guattari adapt from Spinoza, reread by Althusser and a few other 20th century. But the answer is monistic ethology. The affective turn, in a sense, is going in that direction. I want to, for my last point is an answer to Hent, but I want to preface it with two examples of why I think that we are not really, that nobody is in charge of the posthuman condition, or whether why I think we have, I would definitely be normative about this, a moral obligation to recognize it as a big factor of our historicity. So two examples, the computational system that go into the making of the financial crisis. Who's in charge of those? An incredibly complex math of those rating agencies which have declared, you know, Greece has gone, Ireland has gone, I think Portugal is next, Spain is next. They declare entire countries deficient, AAA, quadruple B, minus C. It's like high school that you're getting these ratings. The computational system, who is in charge? Does anybody check those? I would like to check the math of those. Obviously not. It's completely machines calculating and talking to each other, and the human factor running after it, being alongside it. I mean, Catherine can tell us more about it. Second example, the death of Gaddafi. I'm sure you've seen those images, glorious images, a man like a rat in a little sewage somewhere, and these barbaric Libyans pull him out and they put a gun to his head and the world goes up in, there's this Arab Spring, this barbaric tribal warlords, they have no human rights, they have nothing, do they? Blah, blah, blah. You've read the papers. Rewind the tape. How did Gaddafi get to be in that sewage pipe to begin with? He was hit by our Air Force. Did you not know? A couple of Mirages, but the Mirages didn't do the job. What did the job was a drone. And the drone, which, as you know, is the jewel of your wonderful Imperial Army, is an unmanned flying vehicle, which in this case was being flown out of a computer operational center in Las Vegas. It flew out of an American airbase in Sicily, operated out of Las Vegas, hits the Gaddafi convoy, after which Gaddafi scuttled out as a rat and gets then into that sewage pipe out of which he gets killed. Did anybody comment on the existence of the drone? No, sir. The media coverage was on the barbaric tribal war of these nincompoops who have no human rights. The potency of a posthuman thanatological technology was a little thing in The Guardian that I immediately went and I looked up. Drones, they cost quazillions to make, and they are the essence of our contemporary military force, posthuman. Par excellence, we don't even need a human factor unless you consider, of course, and here would be another post-humanity labs, the moral agency of the computer operating in Las Vegas, who's doing, how would he differ from the pilot of Enola Gay who dropped the bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki? What are the implications of this? But drones, follow the drones. Which takes me to Hent's question. Hent, your entire intervention shows why the linguistic turn is not the philosophy that we need today. It's never been my favorite. The linguistic turn implies always a grid of interpretation between us and the world, the linguistic frame. It includes the fantasy, I would say the delusional fantasy, that there is a moment prior to entry into meaning production, which you get in psychoanalysis, you get in Heidegger, you get in your work, certainly in Judy Butler's work. I've never come from that family of post-structuralism, as you know very well. I come from the materialist family. I come from the Kangihem, Bachelard, Foucault, Deleuze, and then through that into always already self-organizing, intelligent matter, with variations and modulations in between, complex ones that produce all kind of modulation, including highly elaborate evolutionary engines, such as the human, but the human is always already the embrainment of the mind, the embodiment of the brain. It's always already intelligence, and there's a whole discussion here also on sexuality in opposition to gender. So I think if you look at the bulk of the scholarship on the posthuman, they're really rejecting this dualistic linguistic thing that doesn't particularly help us understand the transmission of codes and the communication of codes, which has a different semiotic system, is not outside semiotics. It's a different semiotics. And here again, Catherine Hales has done great work. So we do need a fundamental humanities lab as well on the question, linguistic, post-linguistic, what kind of semiosis is at stake? Look, think of the work of Margulis and the contemporary and sort of different type of biological system. It's a huge question, but I wanted to quickly answer that. Self-organizing life has no implicit system of values. It is, in some sense, values neutral. But if we do this with Spinoza, we know that a fundamental passion in all that lives is conatus. It's self-perpetuation. It's a drive to be. And the drive which we can try to experiment with conceptual and new terminology, I have a very, very eloquent way of referring to it, if the chair allows me, and that is... that.